RF signal interference is annoying. To fix it effectively, we need to understand its different root causes. In this video, we are talking about channel interference and receiver blocking. Before we start, we would like to give a heads up to our sponsor's 10th anniversary tour. Congratulations from Electronics Unmasked and thanks for your excellent cooperation. Guys, just check this out on PCB's websites. On this occasion, there are fantastic things to discover and to win. We are looking forward to great new projects. Take the easy way with PCBWay. It can be really difficult to find out the reason, and there are a lot of misconceptions about it. On analog radio, we can hear it. On digital systems, we are suffering from increased error rates as well as from reduced range and data transfer. In extreme cases, the radio connection is breaking down. It could be signals from a neighboring radio service operating on the same channel, or unwanted emissions from an electronic device. Sometimes the sun's radiation is interfering satellite communication, and at low frequencies atmospheric noise may disturb your signal. A strong transmitter in the vicinity may overload our receiver, even when operating in a different frequency range. Intermodulation is a mysterious effect, because the disturbing frequencies are actually not at all present in the air. We will make a separate video about this. While explaining the effects, we are deriving formulas to estimate the root cause, and we are suggesting measures to avoid interference. Looking at the frequency domain, we can categorize the different types of interference. The horizontal axis represents the frequency range, the vertical axis shows the received signal strength in dBm. There's always a noise floor that is caused by external noise sources and the receiver's intrinsic noise. In case you're interested, there is a video about noise, bandwidth and receiver sensitivity on Electronics Unmasked. The receiver's preselection is filtering out the desired frequency band. The filter's passband attenuation is close to 0 dB, while its stopband attenuation is reducing the signals from other bands by 30 dB. For our investigations, we are dividing the frequency range into in-band and out-of-band sections. Assuming a desired signal in white, which is superimposed by an undesired signal, which we are drawing in red. As soon as the undesired signal exceeds a certain level, interference is caused. In a simple scenario, the receiver is using an omnidirectional antenna. For simplification, we assume it's an isotropic antenna. The wanted signal F0 is coming from the top right, and an interfering signal F1 comes from the top left. We want to know under what conditions it is causing interference and how we can avoid it. Assuming we had Wi-Fi networks, then the signal-to-noise ratio SNR must be at least 10 dB in order to achieve a reasonable data rate. 10 dB corresponds to a factor of 10, meaning our wanted signal must be at least 10 times the interfering signal. Using the Friis equation, we are calculating the received power of both signals depending on the transmission power P, the antenna gains G, the wavelengths lambda and the distance R. The resulting condition can be applied to an arbitrary scenario. R1 divided by R0 must be greater than the square root of this term to avoid interference. In our Wi-Fi example, the transmission power and the antenna gains are the same, simplifying the equation. For an SNR of 10, the distance of an interferer must be at least 3.16 the distance to the transmitter of the wanted signal. A wall attenuating interfering signals by 10 dB has a similar effect to increasing the distance. Theoretically, you could operate Wi-Fi networks in adjacent rooms on the same frequency. However, it is not recommended since for higher data rates a significantly better SNR is required. You can change the frequency if a channel is interfered, and Wi-Fi routers can even do that automatically. The automatic frequency assignment avoids the worst, but it is not optimal since the router cannot know the SNR in the corner of the house where I want to use my Wi-Fi devices. A clever positioned directional antenna improves the SNR by 10 dB or more, depending on its radiation characteristics. MIMO devices are achieving a slightly better interference resilience because they can use different propagation paths. At low frequencies, like the lower amateur radio bands, you can apply a trick with a second antenna that is positioned so that it receives the interferer well. Adjusting the right phase shift and gain, we can cancel out the interfering signal. Receiver blocking is a completely different animal. The receiver's preamp is amplifying all signals, and a particular strong signal might overload it. Actually, the effect isn't completely blocking reception. However, the receiver's sensitivity is decreasing the stronger the interference signal gets. Maximum sensitivity is only ensured as long as in-band signals are below -23 dBm and out-of-band signals are below 7 dBm. A strong signal is caused either by a short distance to the interfering transmitter or by high transmission power. You can estimate this using the Friis equation, and I will write it down for you in a logarithmic form, as we can use the dBm values that we have at hand. In our Wi-Fi example, we have 20 dBm transmission power, 0 dBm antenna gain, an operating frequency of 2400 MHz, and we assume a distance of 1 meter. The calculation yields -20 dBm interference signal, which is already 3 dB above the limit for receiver blocking. So, we can assume that Wi-Fi devices that are locked on another network will reduce our receiver sensitivity if they are closer than 1 meter. We would realize that, especially when the interfering network is busy. A broken microwave oven or a strong constant wave transmitter in the vicinity could be significantly worse. Even when the 7 dBm limit for out-of-band blocking is relatively high, it is still relevant in case you are operating a receiving antenna next to a transmitting antenna. The interfering signals are becoming pretty strong due to the near-field coupling. We used example limits that vary slightly between different radio services. I wanted to give you some ideas for analyzing interference. We can summarize the insights and measures for channel interference and blocking as follows. A greater distance from the source of interference is improving SNR and blocking. Similar effects can be achieved by shielding and walls. Changing the frequency channel within the same band can improve channel interference but not blocking. A directional antenna can significantly improve the SNR, however, in case of blocking, it can be only effective when there is no near-field coupling. Band and notch filters, frequency-selective antennas, or a preamplifier that can handle a higher input signal are enhancing blocking resilience. Co-siting of the transmitters can be an interesting option, because when you are getting closer to the source of interference, this ensures at the same time a strong wanted signal. Thus, sensitivity reduction caused by receiver blocking has no effect. At low frequencies, the phase shift method can be an option to reduce interference. A separate video will follow on intermodulation. Now stay tuned and don't forget to support the channel. See you soon in the coming episodes.